My name is Marilag, and welcome to my world. I have been working from home for 4 months now in my new house that I want to show you. Come. So this is my house. It's not completely done yet because, like I said, I moved about 4 months ago. One thing that was so important for me is that I need to find a home where I can get a lot of air, I can get a lot of nature. Apparently, that's what inspires me when I'm working. I came from a city where it's crowded, it's crazy, and none of my friends work with computers, so I didn't really have any, well, I would say, role model. Luckily, I had a brother who is really, really good with computers, and so when my parents decided to buy him one, so they introduced this massive white machine in our really small living room. I think it was like 36 square meters apartment, and we're a family of six. They brought it in, and then I got curious. As soon as I got started, as soon as I wrote my first program, and then that was it. That's the love at first sight almost kind of thing. Being a computer programmer from where I was from was difficult because I didn't have access to the right resources, so I used a lot of time learning. Even now, after 20 years of working in IT, so starting as a junior programmer in a school trying to build solutions for an academic institution, and then eventually moving to Europe, to Denmark, to develop larger scale applications for multinational companies, I would say that, of course, even if it's scaled up, the challenges are the same. It's your access to learning, which should be constant because it changes so fast. Everybody knows that about technology, and you don't want to ignore it because there's a lot of opportunities with all the new things that's coming. But it's difficult to learn, and if you're doing it alone and you don't have access to learning materials and to a network of people that could also inspire and help you, it can be quite challenging. So I started my own communities in the Philippines and also in Denmark, and started sharing my experiences by speaking at conferences, and I'm really, really happy that I get to give back to the community this way. I always start my day on Azure DevOps, and because I have my team in the Philippines, it's very important for us to be able to collaborate efficiently. And one of the first things that we tackle are the bugs that we find on production, and it goes on top of the backlog. And because we have everything automated with our pipelines, and then we use live share so that we can collaborate on fixing the bug, it's very easy for me to see what's going on, change something on the file, and then my colleague can test it, and then locally, and then commit it, and then the pipelines run, and then the bug is fixed in production within a couple of minutes. So at work, I'm primarily the cloud architect, and my main role is to break down a big problem into smaller software components. I think that's really important, especially for development teams, because it's easier to solve problems if you can focus on one thing at a time. But the fun part is how to make these components work together without creating very strong dependency, because if you make them too much dependent with each other, then you're ultimately also just building a big system, and you don't want to do that. So you want to kind of isolate the development of each of these components and make them talk together. And one of the ways for making them communicate using Azure services is to design your application to be event-driven. And if you want an event-driven application, there are different platforms on Azure that you can use for different purposes. So once you have broken down your big problem into smaller components, it's very important to know how to connect these components together. And what you want to do is to put something like a broker in between these components so that they can talk to each other using via the broker by sending messages. So you have to distinguish between a command and an event as types of messages. A command message is something like saying that this component has executed a command, and then it has sort of a contract between the other component so that the other component must know that the command has been executed so that it can react. And one of the things that you can use on Azure for this is something called a service bus. And a service bus is a sort of a very advanced queuing system. So it's built for enterprise-grade messaging. And you want to use a service bus for sending messages as commands. But you also have to distinguish it from events. And events is something that has transpired. So for example, a component has executed a command, and after it is executed, it will publish an event. But once it has published this event, it doesn't really have to worry about who is going to be picking up this event, these messages. So as far as that component is concerned, it's already done. And then you can set up subscribers so that this, and that's optional, so the subscribers can pick up the event and then also now start executing their own command. And for this, you have something called an event grid on Azure, where it's really designed for processing events. So it has an endpoint so that your component can call that endpoint and you can send an event message. And then from that, you can set up a lot of subscribers, and there are different types of subscribers. So for example, you can set up an Azure function as a subscriber or a webhook queues, or even another service bus, which is an advanced queue. So once an event has been published by Event Grid, it goes to service bus. So that's how you sort of orchestrate it. But if you have a need for processing a large amount of events, then you would need something called an event stream. And you can run this as a fully managed service on Azure using something called Event Hub. But if you want to use the very popular open sourced event streaming service, then you can use Kafka and configure your clusters on Azure. But I think the more efficient way is to also use fully managed services for Kafka, like running Kafka on HD Insight or running Confluent on Azure, and it's super efficient. So this is how you put the building blocks together efficiently. So once you have all these small pieces running, the most important thing for a developer is to put that on production as fast as you can with the highest quality. And for that, when we build our solutions, we use automation a lot. So we use YAML on Azure Pipelines to automate our CI/CD so that we can deploy a piece of that software on its own from dev all the way to production, and it's super efficient. So we use this type of architecture and this tooling in one of our largest projects at the moment, and that's to build a self-service portal for developers in an enterprise company so that they can speed up their delivery of their cloud applications. So they use the self-service portal to provision cloud artifacts on Azure as fast as they can without having to call service desk and request for resources, which can take months and even sometimes a year before they can get something running. But now from months to just a couple of weeks, they have something running on production, and they have more time to innovate, and they can maximize the use of the cloud this way.
One thing Marilag has taught me is to be open.
To be persistent.
Always have the courage.
Dedicating time to your passions.
Self-love.
That you can never master something after the first time of you trying it.
Always be true to ourselves.
To love myself.
To continue my search for strong, impactful, and diverse community leaders.
Always do what you want to do and do it passionately.
The best thing about Marilag is that
she is passionate with everything she does.
Is her innate desire to learn new things.
She has me as her sister.
Is her character.
Is that she makes sure that she does her best at everything.
That she's a true role model.
She can be really spontaneous and will give you instant surprises.
Is her ability to explain the technical topic. One of the things that makes her a great conference speaker.
Some of the problems that we need to solve with technology, we need to solve now. We cannot wait any longer. So for example, when the pandemic happened, we have to rally a lot of developers to solve the issues very quickly. And the last thing we need is developers struggling with a technology or a tool. We want them to be happy developers like me. I'm a happy developer, but I also know the pain. I've been through it, but now I'm in a better position with access to learning resources and to a community, and I want to be able to help others to be where I am, where we can solve the problems easily and still have enough time to do other things that matter to us, like our family, and maybe also giving back to the community and empowering others.